Hello friends. As I promised in the last video dedicated to the Pixel Wi-Fi clock Alonzi TC001, I'm making a sequel where I'll talk about how you can easily and simply, without special skills and equipment, install an alternative firmware Atrix Lite and integrate the device into the Home Assistant system. This will allow you to use the clock screen to display any messages, text, sensor readings, reminders, including with animated icons and background, thus extending their standard functionality to the level of an information display. I talked more about the device itself, the capabilities of the standard firmware version, and how to get an API key to display information on the screen about the number of YouTube subscribers in the first part of the video. I'll leave a link in the description. Before we begin, as usual, please like this video. It will help others interested in the smart home topic find it, and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so before. Alonzi TC001 turned out to be so popular that a specialized firmware called Atrix Lite was created for it. In the first part of the video, I mentioned that the USB-C port on the clock is used not only for power but also serves as a full-fledged serial interface. Therefore, to flash the firmware, all we need to do is connect the device to a USB port on the computer. If you're using a desktop PC instead of a laptop, it's better to use the ports directly on the motherboard, usually located at the back of the case. You won't even need to install anything. Just go to the WebFlasher page, you'll find the link in the description. Click the Connect button. After that, a window will appear where the serial interface port number of the clock module is displayed. We select it and connect. Next, we choose the option to install Atrix Lite. We select the option to clean the device and move on to the next step. The last warning that the device data will be deleted. Press Install. Now we need to wait a few minutes for the deletion to take place, and then for the installation of the new firmware. If something goes wrong at this point and the installation is interrupted, no worries. Reconnect the clock and start over. To turn the device on and off, hold down the N buttons. Done, the firmware was successfully installed. Now proceed to explore it. Upon launching, the name and version of the firmware are displayed on the clock screen. The device enters access point mode. In the list of networks, look for the one that starts with the word Atrix and connect to it using the password from the sequence from 1 to 8. The new network requires authorization. Click on this window and proceed to the device interface. If for some reason the authorization window does not appear, you can go to the address 192.168.4.1. Here, manually enter or scan and select from the list the name of your home network, specify its password, and connect. Immediately after connecting, the IP address obtained from the router is displayed on the clock screen once. If you have already connected the clock on the native firmware, it does not change. By default, there is a screen-changing mode, which displays the date and time as well as the parameters of temperature, humidity, and battery charge. Now let's move to the web interface of the clock and familiarize ourselves with its features. The first page is the Wi-Fi setup, where the connection status, IP address are displayed, and you can reconnect to a different network. The network tab allows you to switch to static mode and manually enter the address and network connection parameters. MQTT, here you can specify the connection parameters to an external mosquito broker. We will return to this tab soon. I think everyone has guessed that this is needed for integration into Home Assistant. Time settings. The device can synchronize with NTP servers, but you need to specify the correct time zone. In my case, by default, it was set an hour earlier. Click on the link on this page, and you arrive at a list of codes for cities. Here, you need to find your own or one whose time zone matches yours and copy its code. Insert it into the time zone field, then save the configuration, and afterward, restart the clock to apply the settings. Wait a bit while the page updates after the restart. Now, the time is displayed correctly. The next tab is intended for adding icons, including animated ones. We will return here soon as well. The authentication page allows you to create an account to connect to this interface. By default, access is without a password. File Manager shows the structure of the device's user data storage. Here, media files, icons, sounds, and so on can be stored. In the top right corner, as a status bar, the ratio of used and free memory is displayed. This tab is designated for manual firmware updates. Live View, an interesting option. It duplicates what is currently displayed on the clock screen. At the bottom, there are buttons that allow you to scroll through the screens. There is an option to save the picture and even record animation. Next, the menu for saving and restoring backup copies of settings and clock data. Documentation page, which directs us to the Autrix Lite project portal. And various templates and usage examples. Here, users share their developments in terms of collaboration with management systems, displaying various data from them, and for example, from social networks, statistics of subscribers and views on YouTube, etc. There are examples of automations and notifications, such as currency rates, energy monitoring status, newsfeed. You can find something interesting for yourself, so be sure to check this out. For working with Home Assistant, we will be using the MQTT protocol. We need the server part, which is available here as an add-in called Mosquito Broker. If you use Zigbee 2 MQTT, then you already have the broker. Nothing more needs to be done. If not, it needs to be installed. Detailed instructions are available in my video, the link to which I will leave in the description. Unlike Zigbee 2 MQTT, which can connect to the broker using an internal authorization system, for external devices, we need a username and password, which are specified on the add-in configuration page. Make sure they are entered there. In addition, we need to know the IP address of the broker, which matches the address of Home Assistant itself, and the port, which is standardly 1883, usually, no one changes it. On the MQTT tab, which we have already seen, we specify the address, port, username, and password to connect to the broker. The prefix is how the clock's topic will be called. I didn't change it. The good news is the firmware is adapted for use with Home Assistant and has a special switch, activating which leads to the automatic discovery of the device. Save the settings. Restart to apply them and connect to the broker. To be able to connect to Mosquito Broker myself, I use the MQTT Explorer program. You will find the download link in the description. Connect using the same parameters, address, port, login, and password, and see the structure of the topics. It's similar to a directory tree on a disk. If everything is done correctly, then a topic with the name specified in the prefix field will appear here. I must say right away that within the scope of one video, I will not be able to tell you about all the possibilities and application options of this firmware. So I will focus on what I consider to be the most important. Commands and their parameters are described in the interaction section of the documentation. I will leave a link in the description. I personally learn best from live examples, and I use this principle in my reviews as well. Let's start with an example from the documentation. It's a message that needs to be sent to the notify topic, which is in the clock's topic. It displays the message, "Hello Autrix Lite," colored in rainbow colors for 10 seconds, which is clearly specified in its parameters. In MQTT Explorer, on the right, there is a section for manually publishing messages. I selected the clock's topic on the left with my mouse, then added notify to it in the line on the right, and inserted the example from the documentation into the message field. The sending mode is JSON, set by default. The retain option below is not checked. It saves the last message, which we don't need. Press the publish button. The result of sending this command is the text scrolls from right to left. It's colored in rainbow colors and disappears after 10 seconds. Now it's time to figure out how this can be used in Home Assistant. For working with the Mosquito Broker server here, the MQTT integration is used. It automatically discovers the server after installation, which I also showed in my video. The link is in the description. It can also discover devices that are described according to the system's format. This is what the Home Assistant discovery switch, which we enabled in the web interface, is for. Something similar exists in Zigbee 2 MQTT, whose devices are also automatically discovered. The principle is the same. The clock appeared in the list of integration devices, under the name that was specified in the prefix field. There are quite a few objects here, The main one is the Matrix. It directly controls the device's screen. From the system's point of view, it's a standard light that can be controlled through standard services via automations. The brightness adjustment works, for example, to decrease or increase it depending on the time of day. Color change also works. You can make the clock blue or green, for instance. Since automatic screen changing is enabled by default, this can be seen in the device log on the right by the sensor's current status change. Besides manual brightness setting, you can enable automatic mode, then it will change based on the ambient light sensor readings. The dismiss notification button is designed for forcibly clearing messages on the screen and returning to the standard clock mode. Switches called indicator 1, 2, 3 turn on color markers on the screen, which are located on the right side. The arrows on the icons of the switches show their position. This is what they look like, in red, green, and blue. They can be used as reminders or notifications while the screen continues to operate in normal mode. The next button, Start Update, checks the firmware version. The transition switch turns on and off the automatic screen changing mode. I usually turn it off and use the clock as the main screen. If you want them to automatically change in the next menu, you can specify the effect of the change. There are quite a few, including random selection. Next is the sensors block, where everything possible is added: readings from internal sensors, current screen status, buttons, firmware version, IP address, network quality level, amount of free memory, and battery level, which, at least in my case, stays at around 96%. Now, let's move on to sending messages from Home Assistant automations. As usual, you will find the link to the text file with the code shown in this video in the description below the video. By the way, testing such automations is very convenient using an input button, a virtual button that is displayed in the interface and acts as a trigger. If you want to learn more about this, I will leave a link to a tutorial video in the description. The test automation is quite simple. The trigger is the change of state of the virtual button, which occurs when it is pressed in the interface. The action is a block that sends a message to Mosquito Broker, similar to how we did it directly through MQTT Explorer. Here, the standard MQTT publish service is used, which sends a message to the clock's topic, notify, that will be displayed on the clock screen. In this command, there are three parameters: text, duration of display, and color. Color can be encoded either in the form of three RGB values or a hex code. In this case, ensure all characters are uppercase. There are many online tables for this on the net. I will leave a link to one of them in the description. But you can use any, just remember that the characters in the code must be uppercase. Test the automation to ensure it works. For Home Assistant, displaying sensor parameters is also important. Now, let's look at such an example. Here, in the text parameter, a template is also included that takes the value from one of the sensors, in this case, temperature. I also added another parameter here that forcibly disables the scrolling of inscriptions. By the way, if the inscription fits on the screen, there will be no scrolling either. The output of this automation looks like this. Now, as I promised, we'll return to the icon menu, which can be used to diversify message output. You can use the ready-made library of animated Lametric icons, developed for the analog of the Hero of the Review. Search by keyword or manually for a suitable icon and copy its number. Insert it into the icon ID field in the web interface of the clock. With the preview button, we can check how it will look and if everything is correct. Press the upload button. After saving, the icon will be available for use. They can be viewed in the file menu, and if desired, you can create and upload your icons. File names are used as IDs. Now add a new parameter to the command, icon, in which we specify its ID. Now the output looks like this. Another interesting feature that we will explore in this video is background effects, a small library of which is available in this project. A direct link to them can also be found in the description under the video. Add another parameter that enables one of the effects, called radar. This is how it will look on the screen. Various options are available for the effects as well. color palette, speed, blending, with which you can experiment now that you know how to compose commands for the broker. In the stock firmware, there was an option to display the number of YouTube subscribers. Here, it is also easily implemented, and you can display the total number of views and videos. For this, I made a separate package, the code of which you will also find in a text file in the description. I'm sharing everything I know. The key here is the REST platform sensor, which updates YouTube statistics every 10 minutes. The refresh time is in seconds and can be changed to your own. The request itself is in my secrets file, which is the only thing I can't share with you in this video. It's condensed into a link that I called YouTube. But I can share the template of the request. Here's how it looks in the secrets file. It starts with a tag, in this case, YouTube, followed by a link. Unique in each link will be two parameters, the channel ID, which is taken directly from the browser's address bar on your channel. I showed this in the first part of the video about the clock. The second parameter, API, is obtained through the Google Developer Console. The instructions were also shown in the first part of the video, as these same two parameters are needed to obtain statistics in the stock firmware. If the link is made correctly, then by following it, you will open a page like this with statistics. There are several parameters, total views, the number of subscribers but rounded to the nearest 100, always rounding down, the next parameter, determines whether the number of subscribers will be hidden from everyone or not, and the last, the number of videos on the channel. These parameters are displayed as attributes of the sensor we created. The value of the sensor itself is zero. Therefore, in the same package, based on the statistics sensor, three template sensors are made, the values of which are equal to the values of these attributes. And the sending to the screen follows the scheme we have already discussed, with the only refinement that they go one after another with a specified interval. As we can see, with relatively simple manipulations, the Alonzi TC001 pixel clock can be easily integrated into Home Assistant and can function as a display for a wide variety of information. I'll say again, I've only shown a part of the capabilities of this firmware. In reality, there are many more, and those who are interested can continue to explore it. If you have interesting use cases for the device in conjunction with Home Assistant, share them in the comments. That's all. I hope this video was useful and interesting to you. I would appreciate your likes. They help promote it on YouTube. If you don't want to miss new reviews and tutorials, subscribe to my channel. In the video description, you'll find links to the text file with examples I've shown, the official Alonzi store where you can buy these clocks, resources, and other tutorial videos I mentioned, as well as my Telegram channel. Now available in two language versions, a Facebook page, and a group for discussing smart home questions, join us. It will be interesting. Thank you for your attention. Until next time, peace to everyone.